Auzubillahi minashaitanirrajim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. I am Muhammad Abdul Rahman from Path Pure Line. As you people already know about Path Pure Line, so I would like to little bit more introduce about Path Pure Line in front of you people. Path Pure Line is basically working on different projects on regarding food, nutrition, and halal. Under these projects, we are working on different programs in collaboration with the different private and public sector organizations. So our programs include food safety awareness sessions. Today's training is also the part of this program. Also, we conduct different types of audits and technical trainings in food industry. Along with, we offer advisory and R&D facilities to food industry. Then we have started an online platform for food safety and nutrition publications of different people that have already joined us as a member. We offer consultancy to industry and also third-party certification services to food industry. In third-party certifications like ISO 22000, Food Safety Management System, HACCP, and Halal are the most prominent certifications that we already have offered to food industry. So, as I have already told you about our working procedure, that we work with industry and academia in collaboration. These are different organizations like public and private sector. Through joining hands with these organizations, we are working on these projects that I already have explained to you. Now we will move towards today's topic of our training, that is raw milk analysis and adulteration डिटेक्शन एनालिटिकल अप्रोच. हम बुनियादी तौर पर इस ट्रेनिंग में रॉ मिल्क के मुख्तलिफ एनालिसिस, उनको कैसे परफॉर्म करना है, और इसी तरह इन सभी एनालिसिस की जो बेस है कि हमने इसमें से अडल्ट्रेशन को कैसे डिटेक्ट करना है, कैसे फाइंड आउट करना है कि मिल्क अडल्ट्रेटेड है या प्योर क्वालिटी मिल्क है. सो इस ट्रेनिंग में हम तमाम एनालिटिकल अप्रोच, जो मेथड्स हैं, जो प्रोसीजर्स हैं अडल्ट्रेशन डिटेक्ट करने के, उन पे बात करेंगे. हम जनरल नॉलेज शेयरिंग की बात नहीं करेंगे, बल्कि हम टू द पॉइंट एनालिटिकल प्रोसीजर्स की बात करेंगे कि कौन सा प्रोसीजर अडॉप्ट करके हम किस टाइप की अडल्ट्रेशन को डिटेक्ट कर सकते हैं. सब लोग एक दफा प्लीज कंफर्म कीट कर दीजिए, सबको आवाज आ रही है क्लियर और स्क्रीन शेयर हो रही है सब लोगों को.
यस सर.
ओके, सलमान साहब का क्वेश्चन आ रहा है कि सर मुझे आवाज नहीं आ रही है. आप सलमान साहब प्लीज अपनी हैंड फ्री को जरा रिफ्रेश करें या अपनी सेटिंग वगैरह को चेक करें. ओवरऑल सभी लोग मुझे सुन सकते हैं. Okay, G, we will go for the contents of today's training. Okay, हम जैसे मैंने पहले बताया कि हम इस ट्रेनिंग में मुख्तलिफ जो एनालिटिकल प्रोसीजर्स हैं उनकी बात करेंगे. फॉर एग्जाम्पल हम मिल्क सैम्पलिंग की बात करेंगे कि मिल्क सैम्पलिंग कैसे करनी है. मतलब फॉर एग्जाम्पल इंडस्ट्री में मिल्क टैंकर आता है, उससे मिल्क की सैम्पलिंग कैसे करनी है, जिसपे फर्दर तमाम सभी प्रोसीजर और एनालिटिकल अप्रोच बेस करेगी. तो सबसे पहले तो ज़रूरी है कि मिल्क एनालिसिस के लिए जो है ना कि सैम्पलिंग प्रॉपर हो. इसके अलावा हम बात करेंगे मिल्क का टेम्परेचर कैसे डिटरमिन करना है, और ऑर्गेनोलेप्टिक और सेंसरी इवेल्यूशन ऑफ टेस्टिंग ऑफ मिल्क, देन क्लॉट ऑन बॉयलिंग, साल्ट डिटेक्शन इन मिल्क, अल्कोहल प्रेसिपिटेट टेस्ट, प्रोटीन स्टेबिलिटी, एसिडिटी, लैक्टोमीटर रीडिंग, percent fat or added fat detection in milk, glucose, sugar, added urea detection in milk, carbonates, bicarbonates, starch and cellulose detection, then ammonium, sulfates, nitrates, detergent, skimmed milk, gelatin and formalin detection in milk, hydrogen peroxide, boric acid and borates detection, then pasteurization and sterilization efficiency, and at the end, total solids. So we will talk discuss in detail about all these methods, that how to perform these methods during raw milk analysis and adulteration detection. First of all, we will talk about milk adulteration. मिल्क अडल्ट्रेशन क्या है? तमाम पार्टिसिपेंट्स की तरफ मैं मूव करूंगा कि कोई भी पर्सन मुझे ये बता सकता है कि मिल्क अडल्ट्रेशन क्या है. आप अपना कंसेप्ट मुझे बताइए कि मिल्क अडल्ट्रेशन क्या है. जी, एनीवन फ्रॉम पार्टिसिपेंट्स कैन टेल अबाउट मिल्क अडल्ट्रेशन?
सर, मिल्क में मतलब हम ऐसी चीज़ें ऐड करते हैं जिससे हमें इकोनॉमिकल हमें प्रॉफिट हो. जैसे हम मिल्क में हम ऐड करते हैं वाटर, हमें इकोनॉमिकल प्रॉफिट ऐड होता है
वो मिलता है. तो आप बता रहे हैं ना कि उसका मिल्क अडल्ट्रेशन का अल्टीमेट बेनिफिट क्या लेना चाह रहे हैं, लेकिन मिल्क अडल्ट्रेशन होती क्या है?
मेरे ख्याल से अडल्ट्रेशन का मतलब है कि मिल्क की कोई अजाफी केमिकल वगैरह ऐड करके उसकी कंपोजिशन को चेंज करना.
नहीं, अल्टीमेट फोकस कंपोजिशन को चेंज करना तो नहीं होता, क्योंकि जो लोग मिल्क अडल्ट्रेशन करते हैं या गलत काम करते हैं, गलत तरीके से दूध बनाते हैं, क्या उनका मकसद ये तो नहीं ना होता कि इसकी केमिकल कंपोजिशन को चेंज कर दिया जाए? क्योंकि उन्होंने अल्टीमेटली आवाम को तो ये दिखाना होता है कि ये मिल्क एज इट इज प्योर है, तो केमिकल कंपोजिशन चेंज करना एज इट इज उनका मकसद नहीं होता. जी, कोई और बंदा बता सके मिल्क अडल्ट्रेशन क्या होती है?
इसमें हम ये कह सकते हैं कि मतलब कि वो अपने इकोनॉमिक बेनिफिट्स के लिए उसमें अडल्ट्रेशन वगैरह करते हैं मिल्क के अंदर.
सर, ये तो आपने इसका पर्सपेक्टिव बता रहे हैं ना कि मिल्क अडल्ट्रेशन की क्यों जाती है, मतलब डेफिनेटली पैसा कमाने के लिए या अपनी प्रोडक्ट की वर्थ बढ़ाने के लिए व्हाटसोएवर. लेकिन मैं ये पूछ रहा हूँ मिल्क अडल्ट्रेशन बेसिकली होती क्या है, मिल्क अडल्ट्रेशन किसे बोलते हैं?
सर, कोई भी चीज जो अदर देन मिल्क मिल्क में ऐड की जाती है अडल्ट्रेशन कहलाती है.
एग्जैक्टली, वेरी राइट. मिल्क अडल्ट्रेशन बुनियादी तौर पे दूध के अंदर किसी भी चीज का इंटेंशनली ऐड करना फॉर द पर्पस टू गेट एक्स्ट्रा मनी और गेट सम अदर बेनिफिट्स like increase of quantity of milk. Ultimate effect जो है milk adulteration का वो ये है कि उससे milk की quality disturb होती है, लेकिन milk की quality को एक किस्म से मतलब आँख बचा के disturb करना, ताकि जो consumer है या जो product को utilize करने वाला बंदा है उसको ये चीज़ का इलम ना हो कि ये milk adulterated है या इसमें कोई ऐसी addition की गई है इस product के अंदर. However, उसमें टू गेट सम इकोनॉमिकल बेनिफिट्स कुछ ऐसी चीज़ें ऐड करना जिससे मिल्क की क्वालिटी मतलब अंडरग्राउंड पर्सपेक्टिव में डिस्टर्ब हो. ज़ाहरी तौर पे तो यही शो किया जाता है कि ये मिल्क अप टू दी मार्क है, अप टू सर्टन क्वालिटी पैरामीटर्स को ये फुलफिल करता है. हाउएवर, मतलब इकोनॉमिकल गेंस हासिल करने के लिए मिल्क के अंदर कुछ गैर ज़रूरी अशिया जो उसकी क्वालिटी को ज़ाहरी तौर पे तो हमें ना पता चले कि वो डिस्टर्ब कर रही हैं, लेकिन वो अंडरग्राउंड पर्सपेक्टिव में उसकी क्वालिटी को डिस्टर्ब करें, इसको हम ओवरऑल सिनेरियो में मिल्क अडल्ट्रेशन बोलेंगे. तो आज की ट्रेनिंग जो हमारी टोटली बेस करती है मिल्क अडल्ट्रेशन पे. हमारी ये ट्रेनिंग ऑर्गेनाइज करने का मकसद ही ये था कि हम मिल्क अडल्ट्रेशन की जो आगाही वो दे सकें और किस तरह से हम मिल्क अडल्ट्रेशन को चेक उस पर चेक एंड बैलेंस रख सकते हैं. ओके जी, नाउ वी विल टॉक अबाउट आवर फर्स्ट एनालिसिस, दैट इज अबाउट रॉ मिल्क सैंपलिंग. raw milk की sampling कैसे की जाती है. The scope of raw milk sampling covers all raw milk tankers of any kind or any size. Principle include the sample taken should be true representative of whole lot of milk in a tanker so that analysis performed are accurate or precise. Its procedure, the removal of ice where required. First of all, ice should be removed from milk. Ensure the proper removal of ice from milk tanker or milk silo or can where required. Homogeneous mixing of milk. For vehicles, the milk should be adequately agitated prior to sampling. Generally speaking, adequate agitation times are 5 minutes for tankers under 1000 gallons and 10 minutes for tankers of more than 1000 gallons. The additional agitation requirements time may be required under certain conditions. So for farm cooling tanks, like for at least 5 minutes before sampling. The homogeneous mixing of milk should be considered for vehicles, like the milk should be adequately agitated prior to sampling. The adequate agitation times are 5 minutes for milk quantity of 1000 gallons or 10 minutes for milk quantity with more than 1000 gallons. For farm condition cooling tanks, the milk should be agitated in a farm holding cooling tank for at least 5 minutes immediately before sampling. It should be agitated, its contents should be agitated, the farm storage tanks for more than 5700 liters or 1500 gallons for 10 minutes or more. In case of milks in cans, the milk stored in cans can be stirred with an up and down plunger in circular motion of a disc-shaped stirring rod that has been shown in the upper picture. The disc should be placed on the bottom of the can, pulled up and on the near side of the can, and then pushed down on the far side. I mean to say, ये जो plunger है first one वाला, इसको हमने ऊपर नीचे ऐसे agitate करना है ताकि sample लेने से पहले milk की proper agitation हो जाए.
मतलब मैं निकल
Okay, the mixing of samples in laboratory to get or achieve uniform composition. The uniform composition of milk collected in sampling bottles or plastic beakers can be achieved by pouring the milk from one bottle or beaker to another. The precautions that should be taken while taking sample must be noted. Like dip your sampler to the center of the portion while taking sample. Do not take sample if ice is present in any portion of the tanker, even if in empty portion. Before taking sample, make sure that milk has been mixed thoroughly. Clean the plunger and sampler with water after taking sample. Prior to sampling, make sure that beaker, sampler and plunger are neat and clean. Check the tankers each portion carefully. If all the portions have equal quantity of milk, then take composite sample. Like take equal quantity of milk from each portion. Otherwise, perform portion-wise sampling. The sample should carry 500 to 800 ml of sample for each sample. Prior to taking sample, rinse the milk sampler, that is, we may say it, noppy, and beaker with milk being sampled. After filling of noppy, after filling of noppy with milk, take care that all the milk is transferred from noppy to the beaker. So these were some general considerations regarding the sampling and precautions that needs to be taken while sampling. Two pictures have been shown in this slide. First one is the plunger that is used to mix the sample, milk in tanker from top to bottom. And second one is the noppy that is used to take milk sample from the tanker. Now we will discuss about how to determine the temperature of milk. This method can be used to determine the temperature of all kinds of liquid milk, including raw milk, pasteurized milk, condensed milk, or UHT milk. The principle of this method is based on the fact that the fluid expands on heating and contracts on cooling. This expansion and contraction of fluid depends upon the heat energy present in that fluid. That is, the more the energy in the fluid, more will it expand, and vice versa. So this is the basic mechanism behind noting down the temperature. The energy transferred from higher energy level to lower energy level. The heat energy from any substance, liquid or solid, is transferred to fluid present in thermometer, either or from fluid of thermometer to substance by convection or conduction or radiation, resulting into contraction and expansion of fluid in the thermometer, which is measured on scale corresponding to the temperature of any substance. So the reading of temperature is noted down in degree Celsius or degree Fahrenheit. The standard for temperature measurement, the temperature of milk should be less than 10 degrees Celsius for raw or pasteurized milk. The apparatus required, like thermometer, minus 10 to 110 degrees Celsius, glass, plastic, or SS beaker is also needed. Okay, procedure. First one, thoroughly mix the sample to get representative sample. Dip thermometer bulb in the sample in such a way that it should not touch the bottom and walls of the beaker. Allow to stay thermometer in sample for at least 15 seconds and then note the temperature reading. The mercury thermometers give same reading if say sometime outside the sample, but alcoholic thermometer needs immediate reading of column as column rises or drops readily outside the sample and cannot make spot or point measurements. the precautions for checking temperature of milk through thermometer include note temperature immediately after taking representative sample. Always ensure that thermometer being used is calibrated. This is the most important thing. The thermometer that is being used should be calibrated. Okay, the general hygiene requirements include wash and dry the thermometer after usage, that no any contamination may occur. Okay, now we will talk about organoleptic evaluation or sensory evaluation of milk. Organoleptic evaluation, as you all people know, that it is checking that milk is acceptable in taste, acceptable in flavor, acceptable in color or other sensory parameters. This procedure can be applied to all kind of fluid milks, especially raw milks. The principle include typical smell of fresh milk is due to aldehydes and ketones and low molecular weight acids, typically butyric acid present in milk. The taste of milk is due to lactose and casein. While white color of milk is attributed to fat and protein of milk, the disturbance in any of these components will affect definitely the typical fresh milk color, smell and taste. So all the five primary senses are used for evaluation of dairy products like sight, taste, smell, touch and sound. The greatest emphasis, however, is placed on taste and smell, as milk is basically considered of good or bad quality owing to checking its taste and smell. The apparatus required for sensory evaluation of milk is a water bath, thermometer, and beaker of 500 ml. Okay, we'll talk about procedure. Heat the milk sample between 40 to 45 degrees Celsius so that any odor present may be detected easily by sniffing the container. Nothing the odor by replacing the nose directly over the container immediately after shaking and taking a full whiff of air. That no air should be present while taking the sample. During sampling, take a sip, roll about the mouth, note flavor sensation and expectorate. With this practice, even faint odors can be noted. I mean to say, all the flavor should be noted by this method. The general observations include normal milk has no objectionable odor, slightly sweet and pleasant taste, and white in color. That is the typical taste and flavor of milk. The milk is basically classified in different categories like milk or flavors. The flavor of milk is blend of sweet taste and of lactose and salty taste of minerals. Fat also contribute to taste of milk. It has various types of off flavors due to various reasons. Some of off flavors are as like characterization of flavor defects of milk through lipolytic or hydrolytic rancidity. The rancidity, this type of rancidity arises from hydrolysis of milk fat by an enzyme called lipoprotein lipase, LPL. Lipoprotein lipase, LPL, that is basically responsible for lipolytic rancidity. This lipolytic rancidity is characterized by soapy blue cheese-like aroma and slightly bitter in taste. Next one is the oxidation. That is, the exposure to metals during processing can be affected. it is developed in milk when it contracts with the oxygen and copper. The general characteristics include metallic and wet cardboard like smell or oily appearance. The sunlight may also contribute in disturbing the organoleptic properties. Like exposure to metal during processing can also contribute. The defect of sunlight is caused by UV rays from sunlight catalyzing oxidation in unprotected milk. The milk will show like medicinal like flavor. Cooked or heated, the milk will be characterized like it is caramelized. This defect is basically a function of time and temperature of heating, and especially the presence of any burn on action of heat on certain proteins. The transmitted flavors in milk may be characterized with the hay or silage like flavor. Due to the presence of hay or silage in milk. The microbial activity in milk may also contribute to the flavors in milk, like Pseudomonas fragii. This bacteria can disturb the quality of milk. The precautions should be adopted. Note the observation on related form as early as possible as you test the milk sample. The glassware and other utensils used should be clean and free of any kind of odor that it may not contribute any odors or off flavors. The environment used should be properly lighting arrangement, that is to check the proper color of the milk. The persons or personnel should be enough trained for or checking the organoleptic properties. So now we will discuss about clot on boiling test. The scope of this test covers to determine the heat stability of raw milk. We will check the heat stability of raw milk through this method. The principle includes acid developed in milk due to microbial activities during procuring, handling, and transportation of milk. This developed acid in milk make milk protein, that is casein protein, more heat sensitive. So such milk with more acidity than natural milk when boiled coagulate. On the other hand, if milk sample contains more whey proteins as globulin or albumins, such milk also show coagulation after heating or boiling, as the whey proteins are more heat sensitive than the casein proteins under natural acidic conditions. Standard for this method is definitely the test should be negative for COB. The apparatus required include test tubes, spirit lamp, and pipettes of 10 ml. Procedure include take 4 to 5 ml sample in test tube with the help of a pipette. Then heat the sample on flame to boiling point. After boiling, tilt the test tube generally and observe. The presence of precipitate will indicate clot on boiling test positive. If after heating precipitate are formed, then we will consider the COB positive. the precautions should be thoroughly mix the milk to get representative samples. These are the general precautions. Glassware should be used neat and clean. The hygiene requirements include wash and clean all glassware, use detergent where required, place each and every chemical and glassware after use to their respective place, cover the each reagent bottle after using chemical or reagents, clean your workbench after performing analysis. These are the general considerations for performing analysis. Now we will talk about alcohol precipitate test. The scope of this test covers this methods can be used to determine the protein stability of all kinds of fluid milks, including raw milk, pasteurized milk, condensed milk, or UHT milk. The principle on which this test is based, the protein of milk and alcohol compete for water available in milk. The higher the concentration of alcohol used, the greater will be its power to attract water. Consequently, less water will be available to keep the casein in suspension. So this is the basic principle upon which APT test is based. The standards for this test include the raw milk should be negative at 55 to 60 degree, 60% ethanol solution. The pasteurized milk should be negative at 65 to 75% ethanol solution. UHT milk should be negative at 79 to 85% ethanol solution. It means when these categories of milk are reacted with this specific percentage of ethanol, it should be negative. The reagents required are ethanol solution 82%, 79%, 68%, 65%, 60%, and 55% volume by volume. The apparatus required include pipette 10 ml, glass petri dishes, and test tubes. The procedure for this test include thoroughly mix the milk to get a representative sample. Take 2 ml milk sample with the help of pipette in a clean dry petri dish. Add 2 ml ethanol solution of required strength. Rotate the sample in petri dish 2 to 3 times and observe precipitation in petri dish. The observations for this test are the presence of precipitate will be considered as APT positive. The precautions that should be taken during conducting this test. The strength of ethanol used should be clearly marked on each type used. The pipette and petri dishes or test tubes should be clean and no accumulation of milk residue in it. The light arrangement should be proper for proper visibility. Make sure that none of the chemicals being used is expired or too old. Now we will study the test regarding percent acidity determination in milk. The scope of this test covers the acidity determination in liquid milk. Titratable acidity is a measure of total acidity of a milk sample, including both dissociated hydrogen ions and bound hydrogen. We will study the acid-base titration in this test. The phenolphthalein is a colorless reagent in acidic media. The base added in the sample neutralizes the acid present in sample, and addition of one more extra drop base tends the whole media to become basic, and phenolphthalein present turns pink as it gives this color in basic media. The standard for this test is 0.08 to 0.14 for raw milk. the reagents required are phenolphthalein indicator 1%, that is prepared by dissolving 1 gram of phenolphthalein, 0.1 normal sodium hydroxide solution, that is prepared by dissolving 4 gram of sodium hydroxide pellets per liter distilled water, and then standardized it against 0.1 normal oxalic acid. And third reagent, thirdly, distilled water will be used. The apparatus required include weighing balance, that is accurate 2.1 gram of or any available, Barrett or automatic acidimeter per 25 ml graduated in 0.1 ml divisions. The pipette 10 ml or any available, glass beaker 100 ml, pH meter with electrode, buffer solutions pH 4.01 to 7.01. First of all, weigh 9 ml, approximately equal to 9 grams of sample in a 100 ml beaker. Add 0.5 ml, 3 to 4 drops of phenolphthalein indicator and swirl or mix. Fill burette with 0.1 normal NaOH up to 0 ml mark on top and allow it to drain until all the air bubbles have been removed. Refill burette and drain until meniscus is at 0 ml mark. Allow sodium hydroxide to drip into the beaker with the continuous stirring titrate to a permanent pink color to the phenolphthalein endpoint is at pH 8.3. Read the level of sodium hydroxide in burette by standing at eye level with meniscus and read number of millimeters of NaOH delivered. Okay, the calculation, the formula for this test will be acidity is expressed as percent lactic acid. 1 ml of 0.1 normal NaOH is equal to 0.0009 grams of lactic acid. The percent acidity is equal to milliliters of 0.1 normal NaOH used multiplied with 0.0009 multiplied by 100 over weight of the sample. The percent acidity will be ml of 0.1 normal NaOH used multiplied by 0.1 normal. Okay, we will study now the salt or chloride determination of liquid milk. This method can be used to determine the salt percent and chlorides of all kinds of fluid milk. Principle is silver nitrate added reacts with salts, especially chloride contents in the sample, to form silver chloride and nitrates of sodium or potassium that results in light brown color in media containing potassium chromate as an indicator. The standard for this test is 0.22 to 0.25% for raw and pasteurized milk. The reagents required are 0.1 normal silver nitrate solution, potassium chromate solution, that is 10%. The apparatus required is beaker 10 ml or any available, pipette 10 ml, auto burette or pipette 10 ml, dropper bottle or indicator bottle. The procedure is, first of all, take 9 ml of well-mixed sample in a beaker with pipette. Add 2 to 3 drops of potassium chromate indicator. Mix the sample thoroughly. Titrate it against 0.1 normal silver nitrate solution till light brown endpoint. Note the reading of burette for silver nitrate used. The calculations are percent salt, that is equal to number of milliliters of AgNO3 used, multiplied by factor 0.065. Okay, the percent salt as a chloride will be determined as burette reading multiplied by 0.065 multiplied by standard SNF divided with SNF percent. Okay, now we will study about the lactometer reading of, for SNF solids not fat calculation of milk. The scope of this method can be used to determine the lactometer reading, that is LR, of all types of liquid milks. The principle on which this method works is the function of the lactometer or hydrometer is based on Archimedes' principle that a solid suspended in a liquid will be buoyed up by a force equal to the weight of the liquid displaced. Thus, the lower the density of the substance, the lower the lactometer or hydrometer will sink. The glassware and equipment required are calibrated thermometer ranging from 0 to 110 degrees Celsius, or any available calibrated lactometer 14 to 20 coin, a plastic cylinder of 250 ml, ice box, hot water bath, and stainless steel beaker. Procedure is: take about 500 ml milk sample in SS beaker, heat the sample at 40 degrees Celsius and then cool down to 20 degrees Celsius. Rinse the cylinder with some milk sample and drain it. Rinse the lactometer with the milk sample. Now fill the cylinder with the milk sample completely. Place the lactometer over the cylinder and leave it gently. Add some more milk in cylinder to remove the foam. Wait for about 20 to 30 seconds till the lactometer becomes stable, and then note the reading, that is lactometer reading. The calculations include SNF, that is equal to lactometer reading divided by 4 plus 0.72 plus 0.22 multiplied with fat percent of the sample. It will cumulatively calculate the SNF. Okay, now we will discuss about the percent fat determination of liquid milk with Gerber method. Okay, now we will study about the percent fat determination of liquid milk with Gerber method. This method can be used for fluid milk fat determination. The principle is: everything in milk except the fat dissolves in sulfuric acid. The fat floats to the top. The centrifuge ensures complete separation with no bubbles in the fat. Isoamyl alcohol ensures the complete separation of fat, and the fat content can be measured using the graduations on the butyrometer. Standards for this test are: raw milk should be should include 3.5 to 8.5% fat, UHT milk 3.5%. The reagents required are isoamyl alcohol with the specific gravity of 0.081, sulfuric acid density that is equal to 1.816, and 90 to 91% purity with clear color. The apparatus required for this test is a calibrated butyrometer that can measure 8%, calibrated pipette 10.94 ml, keystopper auto measure 10 ml with stand or pipette of 10 ml, auto measure 1 ml with stand or pipette of 1 ml, water bath, centrifuge machine of 1100 rpm and can maintain 65 degrees Celsius temperature, and calibrated thermometer. procedure is take about 500 to 800 ml of milk sample in a SS beaker, heat the sample at 40 to 45 degrees Celsius and then cool down to 20 degrees Celsius by continuously agitating it. Take 10 ml sulfuric acid in butyrometer with the help of Otto Meyer. Mix the milk sample well and rinse the pipette with the milk sample. Now fill the pipette with the sample above the mark. Pour the sample from the pipette so that the upper meniscus of the sample reaches to the mark. Now pour the filled pipette into the butyrometer gently, making an angle of 45 degree with butyrometer neck in 30 to 40 seconds. Now add 1 ml isoamyl alcohol with the help of Otto Meyer or pipette. Insert the stopper into butyrometer with the help of stopper key. Mix the contents well by inverting butyrometer 3 to 4 times and further shaking if required. Centrifuge the butyrometer by placing in such a way that graduated column remains upward in Gerber machine for 3 minutes for raw and 10 minutes for UHT milk at 65 degrees Celsius and 1100 revolutions per minute. Remove the butyrometer from the Gerber machine and immediately read the lower meniscus of fat column in butyrometer. The fat percentage of sample directly correspond to the reading in butyrometer column. The necessary precautions that should be taken during conducting this test include during filling of butyrometer, take care that no acid falls on the outside of butyrometer. Always mix the contents in butyrometer very carefully. Better to cover the butyrometer with the piece of cloth. Make sure that stopper is properly fixed in butyrometer. Read the fat percent as early as possible. While starting a centrifuge machine, make sure that it is properly balanced. Stir the sample gently and continuously while heating and cooling. Always read the meniscus accurately. Use calibrated Gerber machine, thermometer and pipettes. In some butyrometers, water needs to be added or stopper needs to be adjusted to maintain the level of fat column. Note the reading immediately because sterification of isoamyl alcohol starts if remains at 65 degrees Celsius. For more time and it results in high fat reading. After reading, always remove the stopper and contents from the butyrometer under tap water to avoid any suffocation from acid alcohol vapors. While the butyrometer is in a straight position to avoid any kind of intact with its contents. Water bath should be handled carefully during working. Always take care that hands do not touch the electric connection. Always turn off the electric supply of the Gerber machine water bath before cleaning. Now we will talk about detection of glucose in fresh milk. This method can be used to determine the adulteration of all kinds of fluid milk by glucose. The principle is glucose reduces the soluble blue copper ion to insoluble reddish brown copper oxide that precipitates and settles down, giving following colors with increased concentration of sugar or glucose, like green, yellow, orange, reddish brown, brick red. The standard for this test is milk should be glucose free or glucose negative, except where it is being used as an ingredient. The reagents required are Bradford reagent. Apparatus required is test tube, boiling water bath, pipette, stopwatch. The procedure is take 2.5 ml sample to be tested in a test tube and add 5 ml of Bradford reagent. Place the test tube in the test tube stand water bath at boiling temperature for 3.5 minutes. The observations are if brick red color precipitate is found in test tube bottom after 10 minutes, the test is positive. The precaution that should be taken during conducting this test is stay time in water bath should not be more than 3.5 minutes. With more time, slight positive will change into severe positive glucose. So this is a necessary consideration. Now we will talk about a detection of urea in liquid milk. This method can be used to determine the adulteration of fluid milk with urea. The principle is urea is hydrolyzed by urease enzyme. During this, ammonia liberated will form ammonium hydroxide, that is a base, with water. Phenol red indicator changes its color in basic medium. pH ranges from 8.4 to 8.5 by liberation of ammonium hydroxide. The tube will turn from an orange color to a pink color. The standard for this test is the urea should be negative for all kinds of fluid milks. The reagents required are urease solution 0.2%, freshly prepared phenol rand indicator. Apparatus required is a pipette 10 ml, incubator and test tubes. The procedure is take 5 ml of sample in two test tubes, namely A and B each. Add 5 ml urease solution in each of the test tubes by using pipette. Add 1 to 2 drops of phenol red indicator in both tubes. Place test tube A in incubator at 40 degrees Celsius for 15 minutes, while other will remain in shelf. Observe the color of the solution in test tube A and compare its color with that of B to evaluate status of milk. The observations are color changes from B urea positive, color remains same as that of B, that is an indication of urea negative. The general precautions taken should be the sample should be incubated at 40 degrees Celsius. Urease solution should be freshly prepared, not used more than 3 to 5 days. Only observe the change in color after incubation period, as at initial stage color change may be due to original high pH of milk. Now we'll talk about detection of sugar in liquid milk. This method can be used for determination of sugar in all kinds of fluid milk. The principle is hydrochloric acid. Hydrochloric acid breaks down the cane sugar into its monosaccharide units such as glucose and fructose. The fructose such formed reacts with the naphthol and form violet color compound. The standard for this test is sugar should be negative for milk except that in which it has been used as an ingredient. The reagents required are 35% HCl and 10% naphthol. The apparatus required is test tubes, pipettes 10 ml, test tube stand, electric heater, glass beaker, and stopwatch. The procedure is take 0.5 ml of sample in a test tube and add 3 drops of 10% naphthol. Then add 3 ml of HCl. Place the test tube in boiling water for 10 seconds. Allow to stand the contents of the tube for 8 to 10 minutes. The observations are appearance of light violet color, that is an indication of sugar positive. The precautions taken are while keeping in boiling water, keep close contact on stopwatch. Time should not exceed more than 10 seconds. Now we will study detection of carbonates and bicarbonates in liquid milk. This method can be used to detect the adulteration of any kind of fluid milk with any types of detergent. The ethanol added in milk sample coagulates the casein protein, which is separated from milk serum. The milk serum containing the carbonates and bicarbonates turns the color of roselic acid added from red to pink. The color change of roselic acid depends upon the pH of serum. At neutral pH, color of roselic acid is red, While at basic pH, due to presence of any base, color of oxalic acid is pink. The standard is detergent should be negative in all kinds of fluid milk. The reagents required are ethanol 95%, oxalic acid. The apparatus required is test tube and pipettes 10 ml. The procedure is take 5 ml sample in a test tube, add 5 ml 95% ethyl alcohol in it, add 3 drops of oxalic acid and mix thoroughly. Appearance of pinkish color indicates the presence of carbonates and bicarbonates in milk sample. Now we will discuss about detection of fluor or starch in fresh milk. This method can be used to determine the adulteration of milk with starch or fluor. The starch form a complex with iodine that ranges from blue to blackish color depending upon the type of starch present. The standard is starch test should be negative for all kinds of milk except where intentionally used. The reagents required are iodine solution of 0.1 normality. Apparatus required is petri dish, pipettes 2, 5 and 10 ml dropper bottle. Procedure 1 is take 2 ml of sample in a petri dish using a pipette. Add 1 to 2 drops of iodine solution in it and mix or whirl it thoroughly. Allow it to stand and after 1 minute observe or examine the bottom of the petri dish. Procedure 2 is take 5 ml of sample in a test tube using pipette, bring to boiling conditions and allow the test tube to cool to room temperature. Add 1 to 2 drops of iodine solution in it and mix or whirl thoroughly. Allow it to stand and after 1 minute observe or examine the test tube. The general observations include presence of dark blue or black grains will indicate the presence of or addition of fluor or starch in milk. The precautions are iodine solution should not be very old or it should not be expired. If this there is a same results like positive for each sample, then check the sample and ensure there is not grain formation in it. If present, then replace solution with the fresh one. Cellulose determination in milk sample. The cellulose in milk gives blue color with iodine zinc chloride reagent. The reagents will be used iodine zinc chloride reagent that is prepared by dissolving 20 grams zinc chloride in 8.5 ml water and cold, then introduce the iodine solution that is prepared by adding 3 gram potassium iodide and 1.5 gram iodine in 60 ml water. Okay, procedure includes take about 10 grams of milk in a 100 ml beaker, add 50 ml of hot water and stir thoroughly for about 2 minutes. Pour the mixture on a nylon cloth and wash the residue with 50 ml of hot water twice. Scrape the residue with a spatula and place it in a spotting plate. Stain a part of residue with iodine zinc chloride reagent and another part with iodine solution. The development of blue color in iodine zinc chloride reagent and absence of blue color in iodine solution confirms the presence of cellulose. This method is also applicable to the milk products like curd, rubbery milk, and evaporated milk. Now, we will talk about the detection of ammonium compounds in liquid milk. Okay, definitely the scope of this method covers the detection of ammonium compounds in any sample of raw milk. The reagents used are 2% sodium hydroxide, 2% sodium hypochlorite, and 5% phenol solution. The procedure includes take 1 ml of milk sample, add 0.5 ml of 2% sodium hypochlorite, 0.5 ml of 2% sodium hypochlorite, and 0.5 ml of 5% phenol solution. Heat for about 20 seconds in boiling water bath. Bluish color turns deep blue in the presence of ammonium sulfate. The development of pink color shows that the sample is free from ammonium sulfate. Now, the test for the presence of sulfates in milk. The presence of sulfate salts, which may be added to milk to raise its SNF level in milk, can be detected by using the barium chloride reagent. Generally speaking, to increase the SNF of milk sample, some scrupulous people use sulfate salts in milk, that the SNF is the basic consideration for the general quality parameters of milk sample. Okay, the reagents used are barium chloride, ...5% weight by volume aqueous solution that is prepared by dissolving 5 grams of barium chloride in distilled water and making the final volume up to 100 ml. Second one reagent is trichloroacetic acid, that is 24% weight by volume aqueous. It is prepared by dissolving 24 grams of trichloroacetic acid into distilled water and making the final volume up to 100 ml. After this dilution, we will obtain 24% trichloroacetic acid. Okay, procedure, take 10 ml of milk in a 50 ml stopper test tube, add 10 ml of trichloroacetic acid solution, filter the coagulated milk through Wattman filter paper grade 42, take 5 ml of clear filtrate, add few drops of barium chloride solution, observe for any visible precipitates in the tube. The formation of milky white precipitates indicates the presence of added sulfates like ammonium sulfate, sodium sulfate, zinc sulfate, and magnesium sulfate. The limit of detection of this method is 0.05%. Now the determination of added nitrates in milk. Generally speaking, we consider one fact that the scrupulous people that do adulteration activities in milk mostly or generally add pond water in the milk. Why they prefer to add pond water in milk? This is a very interesting. Basically, pond water contains high contents of nitrogen, as this high content of nitrogen may become from the fertilizers used during field operations or field activities that may add to the water in ponds. So they prefer to use pond water rather than using tap water in milk. The pond water contains nitrates. Definitely they increase the nitrogen content, nitrates contents of the milk. So pond water is heavier than tap water. However, it can be easily detected by the following method. This method actually detects nitrates present in pond water. In the pond water, nitrates may come from fertilizers, as I have already told you. reagents used your diphenylamine that is 2% weight by volume in sulfuric acid that is prepared by weighing 2 grams of diphenylamine and dissolving it in sulfuric acid to obtain final volume of 100 ml. Okay, procedure includes take 2 ml of milk in a test tube, rinse the test tube with the milk and drain the milk from the test tube. Add 2 to 3 drops of reagent along the side of the test tube. Note the developed color. Deep blue color will be formed in the presence of nitrate in the milk sample. Pure milk sample will not develop any color. So that is the basic indication. Determination of anionic detergents in milk. We will talk about the qualitative method for the determination of anionic detergents in milk. The alkyl benzene sulfonic acid or anionic detergent may be present in milk due to intentional addition of detergent in milk or due to insufficient rinsing of dairy equipments. The following method is based on the ionic interaction between the anionic detergent and cationic dye. Anionic detergents have a property to form a complex with cationic dyes. The solubility of dye and dye detergent complex differs significantly as dye detergent complex is relatively less polar in comparison to dye alone. The formation of dye detergent complex between cationic dye and anionic detergents and subsequently its extraction into the hydrophobic solvent layer, that is the lower layer, is the principle behind this method. This method is performed by the addition of methylene blue dye solution and chloroform to milk, mixing of the contents followed by centrifugation. This results in the distribution of dye color in upper layer and lower layers. The relative intensity of the color is noticed in these subsequent layers. The appearance of relatively more blue color in lower layer indicates the presence of detergent in milk. The developed test is sensitive to detect anionic detergents up to 0.0125%. The reagents, that is a 12.5 milligram of detergent in 100 ml of sample. The reagents used for this test are two types, like methylene blue dye, that is a 12.5 milligram is dissolved in 100 ml of water, protect the solutions against sun, direct sunlight, as the dye will faint its color due to sunlight. Chloroform, that is inflammable and toxic on inhalation. Mouth puppeting should be avoided while using the chloroform. The procedure included pipette 1 ml of suspected milk sample into a 15 ml test tube. Add 1 ml of dye solution followed by the addition of 2 ml chloroform. I again repeat, when adding chloroform, it should not be sucked or puppeted through mouth sucking. Vortex the contents for about 15 seconds and centrifuge at about 1100 rpm for 3 minutes. Note the intensity of blue color in lower and upper layers. The relatively more intensive blue color in lower layer indicates the presence of indicates the absence of detergent in milk. I again repeat, relatively more intense blue color in the upper layer indicates absence of detergent in milk. This method can detect presence of 0.15% level of laboratory grade detergent, that is labolene, in milk. Now we will talk about the detection of skimmed milk. That is, skimmed milk is also added in milk to increase its SNF percentage. So detection of skimmed milk powder in natural or liquid milk. As per the law, use of skimmed milk powder is not allowed for adjustment of solids not fat in case of sale or of a cow or buffalo milk. A method for using determining the skimmed milk powder content in natural milk is described here under. This method is based on the fact that the coagulum obtained from reconstituted skim milk powder by addition of acetic acid gives intense blue color on boiling with phosphomolybdic acid due to certain reducing groups present in the proteins of milk powder, which are able to cause a reduction of molybdenum blue, resulting in the formation of blue color. The reagents used are acetic acid 4%, phosphomolybdic acid 1% solution in water. Take 50 ml of milk in a 60 ml centrifuge tube. Place the tube in the centrifuge and balance it properly. Centrifuge at 5000 rpm for 15 minutes. Decant the supernatant creamy layer carefully. Add 0.5 ml of 4% acetic acid to skim milk portion for coagulum of protein. Centrifuge the tubes at 5000 rpm for 5 minutes. Decant the supernatant and wash the precipitate with distilled water twice. Discard the washings, then add 2 ml of 1% phosphomolybdic acid to the washed precipitates. Mix the contents thoroughly and heat in a water bath at boiling temperature for 15 minutes and then cool. The curd obtained from pure milk shall be greenish in color, whereas the curd of the samples containing skimmed milk powder shall be bluish in color. The intensity of bluish color depends on the amount of skim milk powder present in the sample. This intensity will determine the presence of skim milk addition in our sample. Now we will talk about gelatin addition in milk. That is also adulterant added in milk. Gelatin, basically, you all food analysis know very well about gelatin. So gelatin will increase gelatin will be detected in this method. The reagents used for the detection of gelatin include mercury, concentrated nitric acid, saturated picric acid solution. Okay, take 10 ml of sample, add 10 ml acid HgNO3 solution that is obtained by dissolving in twice its weight of nitric acid, and this solution diluted to 25 times its volume with water. Shake mixer, add 20 ml water, shake again, let stand for 5 minutes and filter it. If much gelatin is present, the filtrate will be opalescent and cannot be obtained quite clear. to portion of filtrate in test tube, add equal volume of saturated aqueous picric acid solution. Yellow precipitate is produced in the presence of considerable amount of gelatin. Smaller amounts are indicated by cloudiness. One thing that is notable here, the test is applicable to milk products like curd, yogurt and other milk products. In applying this test to sour, fermented, cultured or very old samples of milk, cream or buttermilk, to sterilized cream or evaporated milk, or to cottage cheese. Use care to recognize precipitate produced by picric acid when added to HgNO3 filtrates from these materials in the absence of gelatin. Such samples with or without rennet and entirely free from such samples with or without rennet and entirely free from gelatin, given standing distinct precipitate when treated as above. In every case, however, these precipitates differ in character than those produced by picric acid with gelatin. The gelatin picric acid precipitate is finely divided, more apt to remain in suspension. It settles only slowly and adheres tenaciously to the bottom of the container, from which it is rinsed with difficulty. The precipitates produced by picric acid in the absence of gelatin are flocculent, separate readily, do not adhere to walls of the container, and are easily removed by rinsing with water. When gelatin is present in sample, gelatin picric acid precipitate will remain in suspension longer after flocculent precipitate has settled. But on standing overnight, the characteristic sticky deposit will be found adhering tenaciously to the bottom and sides of the test vessel. If gelatin is present in relatively high concentration, that is 1% gelatin picric acid precipitate will be voluminous and will settle rather quickly. So this is the basic indication of presence of gelatin in the milk sample. Now we will talk about the detection of formalin in milk. Formalin is a chemical that is basically used in medical field, like hospitals, to preserve the dead bodies of human and animals, and also to preserve some other organs. The basic function of formalin is to preserve the organs. So from here, the scrupulous people got the concept that the milk should also be preserved by using the formalin. However, why there is a need to preserve that adulterated milk? Definitely there have been addition of many unwanted adulterants in the milk. So definitely the preservative will also be needed with the same strength to preserve these contents of the adulterated milk. We will study about Henner's test to determine the formalin in liquid milk. The reagents include concentrated sulfuric acid, uh, the concentrated sulfuric acid is needed to carry out this test. Take 2 ml of milk sample in a test tube and add 2 ml of 90% sulfuric acid containing the traces of ferric chloride from the side of the test tubes slowly. Formation of purple ring at the junction indicates formaldehyde is present in the milk. If sucrose is present, distill the milk sample with the 25 ml and then carry out the test on the distillate. By taking 2 to 3 ml of distillate and adding 2 ml of formaldehyde free milk. The formation of violet coloration does not appear usually when relatively large quantities of formaldehyde are present. The precautions that should be taken during this test include: if HPSO4 is added from the top and not from the side of the test tube, it may burn the milk solids and affect the end results. So this should be considered. Now we will talk about hydrogen peroxide addition in milk sample. We will study about vanadium pentoxide test to check the hydrogen peroxide in milk sample. The reagents include vanadium pentoxide solution that is made by dissolving 1 gram of vanadium pentoxide in 100 ml of dilute sulfuric acid, that is 6 ml concentrated sulfuric acid diluted to 100 ml. This is the concentration of sulfuric acid. Add 10 to 20 drops of vanadium pentoxide reagent in 10 ml of milk sample and mix. Note the color of the sample. The appearance of pink or red color will indicate the presence of hydrogen peroxide in the milk. Now we will talk about detection of boric acid and borates in liquid milk sample. Okay. The reagents used for this detection of boric and borates in milk include concentrated hydrochloric acid. First one, take 25 ml of milk sample in a porcelain dish. Make the sample alkaline with lime water or caustic soda and evaporate it to dryness on water bath. Ignite the dry residue in the dish by heating over low flame to complete charring of the organic matter. Cool down the charred residue, redigest it with 15 ml distilled water and add concentrated hydrochloric acid drop by drop until the ignited residue is dissolved. Then add 1 ml of concentrated hydrochloric acid in excess. Immerse a strip of turmeric paper in the solution and dry it in air. Observe the color change. Appearance of characteristic red color indicates the presence of boric acid and borax. A further check is made by adding a few drops of ammonium hydroxide on the red turmeric paper. It will turn into deep blue-green color, but the red color appears on re-acidification with hydrochloric acid. Okay, now we will talk about the determination of pasteurization and sterilization efficiency. that how can we check either our milk is pasteurized properly or sterilized properly during the process of pasteurization and sterilization. First one, we'll talk about pasteurization efficiency. For that, we use alkaline phosphatase test for checking the pasteurization efficiency in liquid milk. Alkaline phosphatase is an indigenous milk enzyme. That is the basic principle behind this conducting this test. The enzyme activity is destroyed as at pasteurization. Temperature and has been adopted as an index of the efficiency of pasteurization. Since milk is a proven vector for a number of pathogenic bacteria like Salmonella, Campylobacter, Jejuni, and Listeria that are present in milk, the test is of very great significance to the dairy industry as a means for policing the thoroughness of heat treatments or the addition of raw milk to heated or unheated products. In the following method, a solution of disodium p-nitrophenyl phosphate in a buffer of pH 10.2 is used as a substrate. This compound that is colorless in solution is hydrolyzed by alkaline phosphatase of milk to liberate p-nitrophenol. Which under alkaline condition gives an intense yellow coloration of the solution. The liberated p-nitrophenol is measured by direct comparison with the standard color discs in a Lowy bond comparator. The test does not apply to sour milk and milk preserved with chemical preservatives. It should be noted down. The reagents or apparatus used in this test include the buffer solution that is prepared by dissolving 1 gram of sodium bicarbonate and 3.5 gram of anhydrous sodium carbonate in water and making up the volume to 1000 ml or 1 liter. It should be stored in refrigerator and discarded after 1 month. The second reagent is disodium p-nitrophenyl phosphate. The solid substrate must be kept in the refrigerator. Third solution is buffer substrate solution. It is prepared by weighing accurately 0.15 gram of substrate disodium p-nitrophenyl phosphate into a 100 ml measuring cylinder and making up the volume to 100 ml with buffer solution. The solution should be stored in a refrigerator and protected from light. The solution should give a reading of less than the standard marked 10 on a comparator disc, APTW or APTW7. These are two comparator discs or Lowy bond comparator that is being shown here in this diagram. Basically, we consider color differences. When viewed through a 25 millimeter cell, that is distilled water is used as a blank. The solution must be discarded after 1 week. Next, we would need a Lowy bond comparator withstand for 1 inch reflected light, then a Lowy bond comparator disc APTW or APTW7, two fused glasses of 25 millimeter depth. A water bath or incubator capable of being maintained at 37.5 degrees Celsius. 1 milliliter pipette and 5 ml pipette, 1 liter graduated flask, 100 ml measuring cylinder, test tubes, normal size 150 by 16 millimeter with rubber stoppers. Okay, the procedure includes into a test tube prepared 5 ml of buffer substrate solution, stopper, and bring the temperature to 37 degrees Celsius. Add 1 ml of test tube to it, shake and replace the stopper. Incubate at 37 degrees Celsius for about 2 hours. Incubate one blank prepared from boiled milk of the same type as that undergoing the test with each series of sample. Remove the tubes after 2 hours and the content should be well mixed. Place the boiled milk blank on left hand side of the comparator stand and test sample on the right. The take reading in reflected light by revolving the disc until the test sample is matched. Record readings falling between two standards by affixing a plus or minus sign to the figure for the nearest standard. Interpretation include the test is considered satisfactory if it gives a reading of 10 microgram or less of P nitrophenyl per ml of milk. Properly pasteurized milk gives no discernible color. Okay, now we will discuss about the sterilization efficiency. Basically, we use a turbidity test for checking the efficiency of sterilization in milk. The turbidity test depends upon the denaturation of proteins of milk, especially albumin, after sterilization. When solutions of inorganic salts or acids are added, albumin separates with the casein. The sample after treatment with the ammonium sulfate is filtered and heating of the filtrate shows turbidity due to the presence of albumin on account of insufficient heat treatment. If milk has been sterilized properly, all albumin will have been precipitated and no turbidity will be produced. The test is not suitable for UHT milk. The reagents include ammonium sulfate, conical flask, 50 ml, that is apparatus, and reagents are written here. Graduated cylinder, 25 ml, test tubes, funnels, 6 cm dia, beaker, 400 ml, wattman number 12, filter paper, paper 20 ml. Okay, the paper 20 ml of milk in a 50 ml conical flask and 4 grams of ammonium sulfate. Shake the flask till the ammonium sulfate is completely dissolved. Allow the mixture to settle for 5 minutes. Filter through a folded filter paper in a test tube. Keep about 5 ml of the above filtrate in a boiling water bath for 5 minutes. Cool the tube in a beaker of cold water and examine the contents for turbidity by moving the test tube in front of an electric light shaded from the eyes of the observer. Interpretation, the milk is considered sterilized when the filtrate shows no turbidity. Okay, now we will talk about total solids by gravimetric method. In this procedure, a known quantity of milk is dried on a boiling water bath. Subsequently, sample is dried in hot air oven at 102 degrees Celsius, and from the weight of the residue, the total solids content in milk is determined. The reagents or apparatus used are analytical balance having 0.1 milligram sensitivity, desiccator provided with an efficient desiccant, for example, freshly dried silica gel with the hydrometric indicator, boiling water bath provided with the openings of adjustable size, drying oven ventilated capable of being maintained thermostatically at 102 degrees Celsius throughout the total working space. Flat bottom dishes of high 25 millimeter dia, 50 to 75 millimeter, and made appropriate materials like stainless steel, nickel or aluminium provided with well-fitted, readily removable lids. Water bath capable of being maintained at 35 to 40 degrees Celsius. The procedure includes transfer sample to a beaker warm slowly to 35 to 40 degrees Celsius on a water bath with the careful mixing to incorporate any cream adhering to the sample. Cool the sample quickly to room temperature. Heat a dish with its lid alongside in the drying oven at least 1 hour. Place the lid on the dish and immediately transfer to a desiccator. Allow cool to room temperature at least 30 minutes and weigh to at least 1.1 milligram. Add 5 ml of prepared sample, place the lid on the dish and weigh again. Place the dish without the lid on the vigorously boiling water bath in such a way that the bottom of the dish is directly heated by the steam. Continue heating till the most of the water is removed. Remove the dish from the water bath, wipe the underside and place it in the oven alongside the lid and dry in the oven for 2 hours. Place the lid and transfer to the desiccator. Allow the dish to cool and weigh to the nearest point 1 milligram. Again, heat the dish with the, its lid alongside the oven for 1 hour. Place the lid on the dish and immediately transfer to the desiccator. Allow to cool and weigh again. Repeat the operation again until the difference in the two consecutive weighings does not exceed 1 milligram. Now record the lowest mass. The calculation include the total solids content is equal to M2 minus M0 divided by M1 minus M0 multiplied by 100, where M0 is the mass in gram of dish plus lid. M1 is the mass in gram of dish plus lid and test portion. M2 is mass in gram of dish plus lid and dried test portion. Now round the values obtained to nearest 0.01%. Okay, this was all about the test that we have mentioned in this training to check the adulteration in raw milk samples. Now, some generalized precautions should be adopted, like thoroughly mix the milk to get a representative sample. Solutions and indicators should be standardized. Glassware being used should be clean and dry. In case of any breakage, make its entry in breakage record. Use gloves and goggles while handling acids. Make sure that all glassware and equipments are calibrated and neat and clean. No fat accumulation in the glassware. Wash and clean all the glassware after use. In case of any spillage or breakage, clean the workbench after working with solutions. Always wash the hands with soap. After performing the test, clean and wash all the related apparatus and glassware. Place all the chemicals in their specific place by properly labeling and covering. The necessary instructions should be written about chemicals, hazardous chemicals, where required, as maintained in the lab. So this is all about today's training. We have discussed in this training about different methods for adulteration detection. So overall, generally speaking, the thing is that being a food technologist, we should consider the application of these tests for considering or for checking the adulteration of milk.